Welcome to Oregon Voters Digest, the program that brings forward the social and political issues that are important to people living here in the Pacific Northwest. And now, your host, Bruce Broussard.
Welcome again to this segment of the Oregon Voters Digest 2017. Wow, can time pass? Wow. Well, guess what? I've got a special for today. I've got a special for today, and I'm just going to jump right in there because you probably already know him. I've already announced him on Facebook and whatever. The new superintendent of Portland Public Schools, Steve Buel. The new superintendent of Portland Public Schools. He's going to resign.
You're still confused.
He's
going to
resign his position from being on the board, Portland board for Portland Public Schools. And he's just going on and take on the superintendent job. We don't have one, so I'm endorsing him right now. When are you going to be on the job? When are you going to take on the job, Steve? I got to just get you right off the bat.
The 1st of July, they'll have a new person in my place.
So in your place?
Yes.
Oh, that's right. And then you will take on this new place.
Yeah, the new superintendent.
The new place.
I do like the new superintendent a lot.
Well, I guess you do. You look at him in the mirror all the time.
I like
you see him every day. Yeah. Anyway, folks, I've been knowing this guy for a number of years. If there's an icon in the education business of public schools, it's Steve Buel. I mean, he goes back years here in the Portland metropolitan area, especially in Portland. I mean, he started out as, so I call it a career, if you will, years back when the Herb Cawthons were here of the world and the Ronnie Herndons and this, that, and the other. I mean, just the Matt Prophets. I mean, there's a history behind this guy. And the fact of the matter, he stayed there in the school district. He basically left this particular district, went right across the ridge there, and he went to Washington, and he spent some time there. And then all of a sudden, he gets this bright idea, and he comes on the show one day, and he said, "Bruce, I'm going to run for the school board." And then all of a sudden, now he's on the school board. He's on Portland School Board right now. You've seen him on the show many times over. If anybody's given us some insight as to what's going on and the problems we're having in the largest school district in the state of Oregon, Portland Public Schools, and when you talk about diversity, you talk about ESL, you talk about this and the other, I mean, you get it from Steve, just right there off the cuff. Tough job. If he wasn't as independent as he was, if you will, I mean, he could not as function on the school board like he's been doing, if you will, since he's been. He's been like this all this long. Always for kids. That's what it's all. It's his bottom line is the kids and the diversity. The diversity within this community as it relates to kids, the education and diversity. I mean, interesting guy. So, I want to thank you for all the time that you spent in this business, Steve. I mean, you've been an asset. Trust me.
Well, thank you.
Big time. Big time.
Thank you, Bruce.
And I think the last time he and I sort of encountered an issue was the lead in the water.
The lead in the water.
The lead in the water. And as a result of that, I made an appearance, if you will, and other folks, mothers made the appearance, and they challenged that piece, and all of a sudden, Carolyn Smith is not there anymore. And Carolyn Smith is not there anymore. We don't have a superintendent right now. We're still looking for one. Mm-hmm. And that's the first thing I want to ask you right up front with, what happened to the water? Do they have filters on it? Have they
replaced
the pipes?
It's in the bond.
The bond
coming forward.
But what kind of water? 20, well, what kind need, of water are the kids drinking right now?
Right
today?
Now they're drinking still bottled water.
Bottled water.
Still bottled water. Because we need the bond to get the $28 million to fix the water.
$28 million. Are they going to change all the pipes in that deal, or what?
Mm-hmm.
They're going to just totally refab
mm-hmm.
all of the.
One of the things where.
Hope you don't mind this, E-Rep. That's how we're going to do this, people.
We have new people who are running the facility and the finance.
Okay, you got
and
that.
And they're good.
Okay.
And they're good. And they went. And what we did was we sat down and did a several month study.
Okay.
What all the safety issues are.
Okay.
What it's going to cost to fix them.
Mm-hmm.
And we took that study, which is a really good one.
Mm-hmm.
This is kind of a new, it's kind of a new board. This guy who's a head, Youssef Awad, is a really good guy. He's a smart guy, and he's made some good hires. So we got good people doing that now. And we did this study, and we figured out what it's going to cost. And we prioritized all the safety problems.
Okay.
And said, okay, what's it going to cost? And we prioritized them down, and then we put out together a bond. We kind of added it under the bond that we had, because we have a 30-year plan
right.
to fix all to pretty much modernize the schools in Portland.
But the pipes.
So what we got is we
$28 million for just the pipe, the water.
To do the water. To get it cleaned up. Don't have to mess with it anymore. $28 million.
$28 million.
That's if I remember the figure correct, and I think I do.
Okay.
That's what it is. But we got about $150 million in the safety stuff in this bond coming up in May.
But 28 plus another 150.
No, 28 in the 150. And then, but there's also a couple hundred million really in the new schools we're doing, because Portland schools are a problem. We got schools that are 100 years old. They're all but two, I think, over 50 years old. So it's a terrific amount of problems that we have, and that doesn't really catch. That catches the lead in the water, pretty much the lead paint, the asbestos, the radon, and some other safety problems, like some ADA problems, you know, for access, and some security problems that we have. And then, but it doesn't really go after the main one. Of the huge ones is the seismic. Building's going to fall down in a decent earthquake. And so what we're trying to do is build the seismic into the modernization as we go along, because it's about $1 billion to do the seismic.
Jesus.
And then you got to do it over to some degree, because if you just go in and do the seismic but you haven't modernized the building, when you go in to modernize the building and do the other parts of the building, some of which you have to tear out, then you got to redo it. So what we decided to do was do the seismic as we do these modernizations. So we're building a new Lincoln High School, and it's cheaper to build a new one than to modernize the old one, believe it or not. Mm-hmm. We're modernizing Benson, which you like, because I know you love Benson. It's got a lot of stuff, you bet. And we're doing it, we're modernizing Madison in this bond, if it passes. And we're building a new Kellogg Middle School. And we'll take care of all the health and safety and the seismic stuff within those schools, too, which is another... Oh, let me see. Maybe another 180.
Give me 180 million. Give me a number. Give me some.
900.
Bottom line.
I think it's 900.
$1 billion.
It's 900. This bond is 790 million.
Jesus Christ!
Biggest in the history.
$2 billion worth of stuff. I mean, all total.
Yes.
What kind of money we're talking about?
Well,
$2 billion.
But that doesn't modernize all the schools.
Jesus.
See, what we've done for years is we didn't do. We didn't do a very good job since Prophet left, where he was doing a pretty good job of maintenance. But since he left in 1990, last 27 years, we didn't do jack for maintenance.
Well, you did have some good custodians that did.
We had wonderful custodians. We had wonderful custodians.
You got rid of
them. Not me. Those people.
You got rid of them.
I don't want anything to do with that.
The fact they were even putting filters on the pipes.
That had a lot to do with the lead stuff, because we had set up protocols in 2001 to do them, and we talked about that. Yeah, that's right.
We were talking about this on the deal.
Terrible.
In fact, you had the largest African-American employees here at the Portland Public School.
Got rid of them all. No, not from my support.
Jesus Christ.
I wasn't on the school board then.
Wow.
Here we are as taxpayers.
We could be faced with all this kind of money. But in essence, if we had been doing preventive maintenance back during those days,
we'd have
been straight up with no problem. Those people are still trying to refurbish and rehab old buildings.
I'll tell you what really should get your irritation up.
Okay.
Because this is the old board, so to speak. This is the new. So we're changing this stuff up. We're changing it up. We still don't have enough money to do the maintenance we should be doing, but we're changing it up. We're focusing and doing a lot better job. The Kellogg building, which we're going to tear it down and build a new one for, I think it's $47 million or something. Costs a lot to build a new school. The original bill on the Kellogg was $11 million to refurbish it, and they let the roof leak. Destroyed the whole building.
That wasn't happening when the custodians were there.
No, it wasn't.
The real guys. Okay.
But the building was empty. But they didn't, and they let the roof leak, and it ruined the building, and now we can tear the whole thing down and do it. That cost them $30 million right there for letting that roof leak.
Steve, well,
bingo.
This is ridiculous.
Well, but it's not ridiculous. Now we're fixing this stuff.
Yeah, but you're going to be gone. I mean, that's well, but let's get right. Well, that's why I started off this way,
right.
Because there's some major issues that are
there's
sitting there.
There's still some major issues. We're going to talk
who's
about
who's going to cut those
through.
Major issues.
Well, that's the question, and I think there's two good answers.
Two good answers.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. One, the new superintendent coming in is excellent.
Well, if you are the superintendent, that'd be fine.
Oh, yeah, but
if
no,
you,
he's
you,
excellent.
You are going to the next level. And I'm not trying to be funny.
No, I know
this,
you're not, but I mean,
is serious
no,
stuff.
It is real serious. He's excellent.
He didn't have your background.
But he's terrific at getting done what needs to get done. The new guy, Yusuf Awad, is excellent. So we're going to have not only this.
Now, Yusuf is the maintenance.
Maintenance finance.
That's the guy that got rid of that other guy.
He's excellent. And then we're bringing, and so the finance and the facilities we're starting to really put together, and now you bring in this new superintendent who's excellent on the educational side and is a really quick learner. He's going to be fine on.
Yeah, but somebody
stuff.
Was just mentioning right here in the studio that the guy's been he's changed jobs the last four jobs.
Yeah, but see,
what kind of deal is that?
Well, I mean,
last four
I'll
years, the guy's had four different.
No,
jobs.
No, he's had two.
Two? Well, that's too much.
Well, I'll tell you what.
How
happened.
How long have you been in sitting where
I'll
you are?
I'll tell you what happened.
Jesus.
Let me tell you what happened for the guy. They promoted him.
Promoted
twice.
Him. Promoted him twice.
He promoted him and moved him ahead in his first job. Well, his first job was in Baltimore. So people say, well, this guy hadn't been a superintendent, too. But that's malarkey, too, because this guy has, yes, he hasn't been a superintendent, but he's been the guy who's put together the educational programs and made great gains so far in Philadelphia, which is a lot bigger than Portland, and Atlanta, which is a lot bigger than Portland. So this guy comes in, and he's got experience doing huge districts and working with the education stuff. So he comes in. So what he did, he was a principal. They put him in charge of all the principals when he was in Baltimore.
Okay, okay. Well,
then the guy, let me finish the guy. Let me finish. Let me finish. Okay, well, yeah, but I'm just telling you what this guy's going to do when he comes. Then, because you asked, you said, well, he had two jobs, so let's talk about that. So he goes in and takes over the job. They hire him for one out of two jobs. And then, after not very long, they put him in charge of both the jobs, the two that were there, two assistant superintendents. They move him in charge, and they give him a huge promotion because he's so good. And then Atlanta says, we'll give you a bigger promotion yet. We want you to come down to Atlanta.
Well, what's the track record as far as the kids learning?
Excellent.
What do you mean, excellent? Definition.
This guy.
So in Baltimore, when I hear about Baltimore, I hear about the writing and all that other good stuff.
Then, well,
and those kids. And
in his school in Baltimore, he was like the top in the state.
Top in the state?
In Maryland.
In Maryland.
Yeah, big time.
But when I hear
and
from
then
Maryland,
he,
is a whole different ball.
Well, but Maryland's not many different than any place. Most of the states are pretty close to the same.
There's what?
Massachusetts. Most of them are pretty close to the same. Massachusetts.
All problems, right?
All problems.
Okay, so there were
all
problems.
Yeah.
There.
Oh, sure.
There's
still
problems there.
Yeah. Well, sure, but he didn't. But
so now he's coming over here.
No, his school did terrific, and they took him and put him in charge of all the principals in Baltimore, and say, do with us what you did. But he's still a principal. So then they gave him. He got a huge promotion to go to
more money.
Philadelphia, but way more responsibility. And then he got a huge promotion to go to Atlanta, more money, I guess, but more responsibility. And now he's getting promoted into Portland as a superintendent, which is where he wanted to be, is to be a superintendent. So, I was just, you know, I criticize the process.
Well,
We talked about this on the deal.
And you had a lot of job trying to get the right vote and get
I am so happy.
Put the job application together.
We were so lucky. This guy is terrific.
Well, I can see you spent some time with him.
Several hours.
So therefore, you.
He's terrific.
Well, you know, come on.
You're gonna love this guy.
No, come on. Second thoughts from the way you
put him on here.
The way you're talking about this guy.
He's really good.
In all due respect, you may have just gone to do another term. The way to keep it going, because I don't know of too many people that can make sure that the school district, Portland Public School, will continue to be focused, if you will.
This guy
on the issues.
This guy makes me pretty happy about the direction that we're going because I think he's that good. I think
you
he's
think.
Terrific.
You say you use the word think. Well, yeah, how do you know? You can't guarantee that.
You can't guarantee it.
Okay, that's what
no,
I'm saying.
No, but you can never guarantee it.
Well, the only way you can guarantee
it. You can never guarantee
it. The only way we can guarantee it is you got to run for office.
You can draft Hank Aaron and you're not really sure he's going
to
be good.
I'm going to have to change my whole format here. We're going to be talking about the campaign and how you're going to be getting out, knocking on doors, and making sure you're going to be looking out for the welfare of the public, for the public here. And these kids, especially.
That's why
I'm the way your head is.
That's why I'm 100% behind this guy.
So you're still going to be involved.
Wait, this guy reminds me of
Matt Prophet or something?
Absolutely.
So what was it?
He reminds me, he's kind of like a, you talked earlier about
what was the guy's name? What's the guy's name?
It's Donyell Dickey.
Donyell Dickey.
Mm-hmm.
Was he African-American or black?
He's African-American.
Or Hispanic
African-American.
Or Asian?
It's African-American.
I mean, wow, really?
Mm-hmm. It's African-American. He's smart as hell.
That's a tough job.
It's a real tough job. And what's kind of irritating to me, and not you, but what's kind of irritating to me is that people are already undercutting. They're already undercutting. Well, he didn't have this. They're undercutting. Well, I wanted to go to an open process so people would go, geez, this guy is good. But they're undercutting.
Look, in all due respect, okay, we've seen these kinds of situations. I mean, they might be the brightest person whatsoever, but we're still sitting in Oregon, i.e. Portland, and we still have the reputation in the state of Oregon and the city of Portland. It's the whitest city. It's the whitest city in this country. Plus the fact here in the Portland, we got some other major issues. Now, how can he actually do the job? And then plus the fact we got gentrification here. We got problems with the diversity.
It's really a hard job.
We got the whole immigration problem aspect of it. And you know, hey, I'm not trying to take anything away. I know who Bruce Broussard is. You and I've talked about solutions about a lot of things, but I can go so far, and I've run for office many times over, and I think I'm more than qualified. But the fact of the matter is, in the environment that we're in, you got to understand what's going on. I do understand what's going on, but I'm just asking that question. Do they know that he's an African American and he's going to be able to be as effective? He might be the smartest guy in the world, but buddy, in Portland, Oregon, as an African American, that's going to be a tough nut.
You've had people who were really good before. Prophet was a terrific superintendent.
He was military. Now, if you wanted to say, Bruce, well, tell you what, we need a good gunnery sergeant marine like you. I could take that superintendent job overnight, and I'd still have you there. You'd be assistant. Couldn't we run a deal? I'd be the jarhead, dude, right? And you'd be the guy. We'd run that school district like a man out of style. With a construction background, I'll cut the construction by half of what it would take.
You know,
I take it by half. See,
yeah, the
sounds like toilet seats. As far as I'm concerned, as far as those dollars that we're spending, it's
big dollars to do that stuff. Yeah, it's pretty complicated, too.
Well, I tell you, and that's why
it's complicated.
In all due respect, that's why the country is pushing towards that school choice and vouchers. You know, you got four kids and $11,000 a piece. That's $44,000. I can hire a pretty good tutor. To teach some kids.
They don't give you the vouchers for tutors.
Huh?
They don't give you the vouchers.
No, but I'm just saying to you, we're talking about solution here right now. You would be no problem. You could start your own school tomorrow, and I know darn well that the output would be awesome.
The vouchers, the voucher thing is one of the worst things for public schools.
Let's talk about that for a minute. Why is it so violent? But see, for people.
Okay, I'll tell you why it is.
I just want my kid graduated, and I'm not getting the results out of the public schools. What's that talk about?
Well, where are they getting the results? The private schools get pretty good results generally. They're not vouchers.
They get paid.
Well, but they have private. They have private schools. You go out to Jesuit.
Okay.
Outstanding school. Okay. St. Mary's downtown.
Aren't they
Oregon
getting
Episcopal?
And don't the money
no, they don't
the
get
kids?
Any money. That's total.
They should.
No, let me finish one. Those people are people who can afford, who send their kids there, can afford to send their kids there.
Okay.
Some of them get a scholarship occasionally.
Okay.
But those people are oriented towards education. I can afford to send my kid there. I got the time, I got the energy, I got everything.
And I got the money, right?
And I got the money.
But the kids got the
okay,
money.
Okay,
no. Why can't they go there?
Well, because for one thing, St. Mary's gets to pick who goes there.
What?
Sure.
Not in this society. Oh, I can see why we
and you got
now we
Jesuit
got the whitest
picks.
City. Now I know
Jesuit
what the problem
picks.
Is. Now I know about the whitest city.
Oregon Episcopal School.
In Portland, Oregon?
The Catholic schools, which are
Jesus
excellent. Central
Christ.
Catholic's a
you
terrific
be
school.
Kidding me.
They decide who goes there.
What?
If you go into...
Now I was a Catholic at one
if
point
you go
time.
Into,
no, I'm not,
if you go into a private school and they don't think you're doing what they want you to do, they send you packing. If you go into the public school, you're not doing what you want to do, they try and figure out how to help you. That's the difference. Vouchers end up giving more money to rich people. So if it's, let's say it's, I don't know what it is.
Wait
let's,
a minute.
Let's
no,
say,
no, no.
Let me explain
no,
it to
no.
you.
No, no, go on.
If they got, let's say a school costs $22,000 a year
okay.
to send your kid
okay.
there.
Okay,
okay. Okay, and your voucher's $11,000.
Okay.
So your kid goes there as long as you got $11,000 more. How many poor kids down in the middle of difficult times in Portland have another 11,000 to go to that school?
But if they're getting the results, if you will, give them another 10,000.
So we're going to go to 22,000
yeah, as long
for
as the
everybody?
Kids are graduating.
22,000?
As long as they're graduating and we're not recruiting from outside of this country. I mean, we've got qualified folks here now that's got jobs. We're creating middle-class jobs. I mean, they're making more money. They can put more money back in the system. That money's covered. Am I on, are we on course here?
No, you're not on course.
Well, anyway.
You're not on course.
No, we're getting
not,
some things out
you
of it.
If you're doing vouchers, you give it to the people who already can afford to go someplace else, basically. They can get their kid there and on and on and on.
But people feel that we're not getting anything for the 11,000. We need
no,
more money,
no,
don't
we? Got a lot.
Don't we
no,
need more
yeah,
money?
Yeah, yeah.
We need more
no,
money,
no,
right?
No,
we need
no.
the 20,000 all total.
Well, I don't think they need that much.
You don't need that much?
Then no, but you need more money than
school.
We have.
Now, what about that superintendent at the public school over there? The private school.
Well, if you're talking, are we talking charter schools or private
no,
schools?
Private schools.
Well, heck, if you're in, I don't know what do they pay a nun in the Catholic Church? I think they pay them hardly anything.
Do nothing. I mean,
well,
I
but they're the people who run that school, maybe.
Yeah.
You don't
have
to pay them.
Yeah.
Private schools also make money, so they can
pay the bills.
Pay the bills. That's
now you,
right.
Now you got but charter you, schools. Charter schools are still public schools.
Yeah, but charter schools aren't any better than public schools all the way across the country. All the stuff, when they fang that out, charter schools, public schools, they all come out about the same.
Really?
Yes.
We've got
absolutely.
The top notch
they come out about
charter
the same.
School in the city of Portland.
They come out
his
the
name
same.
Is Tony Hobson. Why wasn't he interviewed for a superintendent? It's been said that
He never applied.
Has anyone approached him?
Not that I know of, but is he qualified to be a superintendent?
Well, must be because he's.
Well, you
got
to have an administrative. You have to have an administrative certificate.
Well, he's running that operation.
You have to have an administrative certificate. I don't know if he has that.
Administrative certificate.
Yes.
Give him one.
That's the state.
No, but my point is, look at the results that he's having.
Well, yeah, some of his results are pretty good.
No,
but
he's the top. I mean, the media. I mean, we don't.
Are we going to talk here? Or are we just going to go?
Well, no,
I mean,
I'd
be glad to
you.
Talk.
Oh, you do just say, Bruce, I'm going to run again.
Well,
I've got more things
I'm going to. I'm just saying that Tony, the SCI does a really good job.
Yes.
But they also get to kind of pick their kids. Yeah, sure. If a kid doesn't do good, you can send him packing if you want.
You can do that.
Sure.
So he doesn't.
SCI.
He doesn't look at all the kids.
Charter schools.
The tough kids.
He doesn't have to necessarily do them though. I'm not taking away from what they've done. They've done a lot and they have a lot of tough kids, I'll bet. But there are, when you look down at it, it's not necessarily any better and you can put it across the system. Because we're dealing with 47,000 kids. He's dealing with maybe, 50?
Yeah, but that's not what the media said. Fake news. Now, we're in the fake
media
news.
Media can say what they want, but they don't
news.
Really look into it.
They don't look into it.
No,
okay?
But I'm
really
not taking away from SCI.
Okay.
SCI
okay.
does a great job, but they also have certain kids that end up in SCI with certain parent backgrounds, and they also get a whole lot of extra money. SCI costs. I'll bet you in the end, if you looked at everything and you counted everybody SCI probably is paying more per kid than the public school.
Yeah, but they're not getting $11,000 per kid, though.
Oh, but they're getting, they got, have you ever seen been to SCI and seen the board of all the money they are donors?
How
and
much
stuff?
Is it? So I mean,
it's a lot. I don't know.
$20,000 maybe?
Per kid? I have no idea. But it's not what I'm saying is that it's not apples to apples. We got 47,000 kids. We got to educate every kid in the whole
public,
place.
Stephen, all due respect, the public parents are looking at one thing, the results. Are my kids getting educated? Are they able to go to college, i.e. and get themselves a good education so they can come out and get a job?
I'm not fighting on that.
Do you understand what I'm saying? It's not about the 11,000. It could be 20,000.
Asking me to understand if they're about to saying it's kind of crazy, because we've talked about that for years, you and I, about how we're not doing as good a job as we should. And there's many places where I've fought for it. But the answer is not vouchers, because that's going to end up making a lot of kids worse, their education way, way worse. The answer is not charter schools, because that ends up kicking money away from the schools where you have to educate every kid.
The public schools are not doing anything.
What do you mean? Lincoln High School won top in the country.
But why are they still classified as the country?
I mean, it's a major, big-time school. What do you mean they're not doing anything?
Well, Portland Public Schools have already been accepted
by statewide. Benson High School graduates.
Those are one or
Benson
two.
Benson High School. Exactly. So
you got voc ed. You got voc ed there. You don't have voc ed for the rest of the kids, right? Am I right?
No. We got 54 programs now. We've gone up from
programs.
Well, different vocational ed programs in the city.
You just started that. You just got that when you've been on the show.
We popped up. And we had like 22 or something. I don't know the exact numbers, but we're now up to 50 some. We're putting voc ed into school after school.
The point I'm making, Steve, and all the I'm not trying to cut. The
I'm
point
not
I'm
trying
making,
to wonder
no,
what
the
your
point,
point
I'm making is that these things that we're talking about right now wouldn't even exist had you not been on that board. I know that. I've got the history. I've been there. That's why I'm talking to you the way I'm talking to you. I'm not going the old normal form. No, you're not that kind of a guy. You're definitely. You're result-oriented. Remember, there was no voc ed stuff. There wasn't even a discussion until you got
there was some,
on the board.
There wasn't there like was we nothing. Have now.
No, it wasn't. And
we're
then
doing you, better now. We're doing you, better. We got the, ways to go yet.
But you're going to be gone.
But yeah, but they've got like they got voc ed built into the Franklin
Steve,
and
Steve,
built in
Steve,
and stuff.
You understand what I'm
they
saying?
They got some good people coming.
Who's going to next
me?
Step? I mean, are you going to be around? Are you going to stick around? I mean,
you got.
Are you going to be around after you leave? Are you
going
to come back?
I'm not going anyplace. I'm paying attention. Sure.
Okay. Good. So we'll be.
Sure.
Able to
I'm already working on people's campaigns.
Oh, good.
Trying to
campaign,
make sure.
Are you? Let's talk
trying
about
to make
that.
Sure some people.
So who's going to
are good
you?
Stuff to
any,
do.
Any idea?
There's two people. One is a woman by the name of, that's running, two people that are running right now. One is Jamila Singleton Munson, and the other is Rita Moore.
Rita Moore.
So Rita Moore is a person who has...
She's an African-American?
No, Jamila is
African-American. Oh, Jamila is. Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. So that must be a plus then. Maybe a good plus then. What's the deal?
Who
is she?
Certainly not a negative. She's a woman who... I don't know much about her because I've been on that school board for 4.5 years and I don't think I've ever met her.
Well, I
don't
remember.
She might have come to a couple board meetings, but she's kind of new coming out of the, you know, coming out of new. She's
and
brand
what about,
new.
What about Moore?
Rita Moore's been going to meetings for 15
really?
Years.
So she's got
day
background.
In, day in, day
wow.
out, every.
Wow.
I mean, she's been at tons of stuff. She's been.
Wow.
She was wow. has really been pushed on a lot of fiscal responsibility and the budget
wow.
stuff.
Wow.
She was the chairperson of the budget
wow.
committee.
That should be a natural.
She's
then.
The DBRAC.
So who are you supporting of the two?
Well, I like Rita Moore. She's
Rita Moore,
a good,
it sounds like she's got a big background.
It's kind of interesting on the support if you want to look at it. Paul Anthony and I are both supporting Rita Moore.
No problem. Okay.
Pamela Knowles and Matt Morton are both supporting Jamila.
Really?
They're on her endorsements.
Really?
Yeah, Pamela Knowles.
I've been knowing
big
Pam
time.
For a long, long time. And in all due respect, I like Pam. And I knew her.
Nice husband. Enough woman, I guess.
Nice lady, but in all due respect, she's just been just the counter aspect of it. You know, in all due respect, the private sector or wherever elites tend to be pretty well in control of the Portland Post. We've been there for years. We know that.
Well, yes, the private sector, the West
the
Hills,
yeah,
so
the West
to speak,
Hill,
has
yeah, yeah.
controlled but, since... Since 90,
yep,
they
yep,
didn't control
yep,
in the
yep,
profit time because yep. profit cared about each kid.
Yeah, yeah.
And this is what I think it's gonna. This is what I like about the new superintendent. He's like that. He cares about each kid. He's not gonna come in and kowtow to the West Hills, you know. And they're not one of the things.
But
in,
Steve, he's black. I hate to put it that way, Steve. He's black in this environment.
That's one
my
reason
friend,
you
he got to be a tough, tough dude.
He
now,
is.
If he was already
tough.
Existing,
he's
and all due
dude.
Respect, that's why I bring up Tony Hobson's name, because when he knows how to raise money, he knows the terrain, he knows the kids, all that stuff that you're talking about, I thought it would have been a natural. But now we got this new guy. He looks huge. But, buddy, it's a tough nut. I mean, he can't be a Steve Buel. unless you're there as his assistant.
One of the things
have you thought about that being an assistant?
One of the things that he
have you
does,
thought about that being an assistant?
One of the things that
have
he
you thought
does
about
well,
that being an assistant.
The one of the things that he does
totally
well. No, I'm not. I wouldn't go back and work for the school system. After being on the school board, the next, like, work for the school system, I don't think it's ethical.
If you're superintendent, it'd be great.
Not ethical. But the point is, one of the traits that I really liked about this guy coming in is that he has a track record of getting things done. And he's doing, his track record is getting the stuff done, which is similar to what I want done.
You know how many blacks? You know how many minorities are there in the Baltimore area compared to Portland?
I think in Atlanta, when they're like 80% or something.
That's quite a bit, ain't it?
Yeah, it's quite a bit.
How many is there? 80% here?
Yeah, I don't think so.
but he's gonna have to be a knight in shining armor. Was he prime military or was he prime military? What's his resume look like?
I don't know, but he's he's been an educator.
I'm not trying to knock
he's
you.
He's been an educator.
I'm looking at the results.
He's been an educator.
The real world.
Pretty much an educator. Came out of a really tough family life. So he's been down in down in areas where it's pretty darn tough.
My concern is Portland, Oregon.
This guy's going to do great in Portland if people don't undercut him
I'm not trying to undercut him. I mean, you should be here. In fact, when I interview
him. Well, I think we'll get him to come over and
there
be
you go,
on.
With you. You're
we'll
be
talk
there.
To him.
You'll be there right there.
I don't know if I'll be there, but he'll be
you
there.
You saw him before.
I don't know if I want to. I don't want
to. I'm a nice guy, Steve. You know that. I'm just going to ask the questions.
Yes, I know.
What are you going to do for these kids?
Yeah, and he'll answer.
Okay.
And you'll go, wow.
Okay.
This guy's really good.
All right. But like I said, now you.
I'm all in on this guy.
Okay,
you
right,
can hear
right.
it. You can hear it.
Well, I can hear
you
it.
Know who the big skeptic for the last since 1975 is.
Assistant. You come on and be an assistant.
Let's go into what we're actually doing.
Okay. I'll tell you what we're going to do. We're going to take about 1 minute. We're going to do a 1 minute break real quick, like just on and off, so we can make sure we spend this after. I got a lot of questions for him. Okay. That okay, Dave? Okay. All right, buddy. All right. We'll take a short break, make a little quick announcement, and we'll come right back on. Thanks.
You are watching Oregon Voters Digest. This program can be seen again on these channels on these dates and times. Tell a friend.
Okay, welcome back. Look like I'm back, folks. All right, then. Gee whiz, like I said, I've got Steve Buel here. We're talking about the kids across the board. In fact, we're even talking about diversity. We're even talking about some of the issues that are relevant to what we're talking about here in the Portland metropolitan area. There's gentrification. There's a whole bunch of other stuff. But the fact of the matter is that we got Steve here, and he's answering the question. Thank you very, very much. I mean, you're doing a great job. Since you're not going to be leaving anyway, that's the other thing. Now, we were talking about Rita Moore and this other lady.
And I didn't kind of finish there, really, when we break.
Well, you said you endorsed her, so to speak.
I endorsed Rita Moore, but there's one of the reasons is because of her really strong background. And I know her attitude. I know her attitude about the schools. I know her attitude
she's
about
more qualified.
Kids. But another of the reasons is there's some question about the corporate education reform that where people are making all the money off. Well, Jamila, and people need to ask her about this because I don't know the answer, but I do have some concern about it. She's kind of works for what's called Teach for America, which is one of the groups that undercuts the unions throughout the country when they're trying to privatize things. They bring in Teach for America because they come in with 5 or 8 weeks, I think probably 8 weeks of training instead of 4 years.
But your main thing is that she understands diversity and she understands kids at the end of the day.
Who?
Rita.
Yeah, Rita does, yeah.
Yeah.
And but that lady, I've hardly ever seen her. Never seen her that I know.
I'll have her on.
Get her on. I think that's great because there's some questions people need to ask.
She might be
a
solid person. Yeah.
She might be really good.
She might be a solid person. She's almost like Donnell. You know, she's African American, right? she's African American, and if she's from the area, maybe she can talk about her background and her rationale.
She went to Grant. She went to Grant.
Okay, good. No problem. We'll talk with her. Okay. Let's talk about the. What about the other election? Isn't there some?
Okay, there's two others.
Okay, two others. How's it look?
You've got nobody has put in to the state for either election. One is Curler's seat, and the other is Pamela Knowles' seat.
Well,
Pamela
Knowles. She's up for Okay, maybe we can have her on.
Oh, I'm sure she'll be more than happy to come on here and get beat up.
I know her.
There you go.
She wouldn't get beat up. I mean,
but
she,
there's really
she's
nobody.
Been there for a long time.
There's nobody who's signed up to run, put their committee in to run in those two spots. But there are a couple really pretty good people. So in Curler, in Pamela Knowles' race, there's a woman by the name of Virginia LaFront.
Okay.
And LaFort, excuse me. And she was the woman who went after the lead poisoning in Alameda.
Okay.
And then there's supposedly going to run, though I haven't talked to her. I said, hey, if you're going to run, give me a call. I'll talk with you. A man by the name of Scott Bailey, who's been around the school district for years.
Okay.
But I've had about two conversations with him in 4 years, so I don't know.
Is he involved? Does he go to the meetings?
He goes to all the meetings all the time, and he knows the stuff.
Okay,
but is he there on the issues? I don't know. I haven't seen it. Virginia LaFront appears to be there on the issues. I kind of
Which one are you?
I don't know. I voted today. I'd vote for Virginia.
Okay. What about the other seat?
The other seat.
That's the one that's Pam, right? That's Pam, right? But
no, that was Pam's. The other one is Curler.
Okay.
Where Curler is now. And the woman running is a woman by the name that I know appears to be running is a woman by the name of Tricia Parks.
Mm-hmm.
Now, see, there'd be a good person to come on and do some of the stuff that I do because she's a experienced teacher in Beaverton.
Oh, that's good. She's a teacher.
She's an experienced teacher
in
Beaverton. And
right
she was actually president of the Beaverton Teachers Union
point. That's a good one.
So I've sat down with her for a couple hours, and she's pretty smart and pretty good. She'd be pretty good. But see, if you think about it, now think about that. You got those two, if those two women were elected, and you got Paul Anthony, the right attitudes. So there's three people with good attitudes. And so then you go over to the other one and the other side, and I like Mike Rosen, but I can't tell where he is all the time. And so you kind of come out.
You need four votes.
It's kind of three to three, and the Rita Moore one is
that's number four.
Kind of four.
Oh, wow.
So do you go over with Pamela Knowles and Matt Morton?
Or do you go over
with Paul Anthony and me on the other side? And so
well, that's
Rita
why we
Moore's,
need to interview Pamela. I mean, Pam needs to come on because she represents that other end of it. And in all respects, she might have a better argument. But
maybe
both
she
of you can come on. Maybe both of you can come
on. That'd
be
good.
Wouldn't that be a good one?
That'd be you and Pam.
You could put it up as
Bickerfest.
No, but I'll be a good guy. In that particular situation, I'll ask you guys to give me a question or two. You know what I'm saying?
You know what I'm saying?
And then we agree, if you will, these are the ones we'll deal with, and then we'll go, right? But at the end of the day, it's about the kids and the graduation and the issues that are happening. Right?
It's about the kids, but one of the things, this graduation thing is a funny issue.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, for one thing, they've changed graduation requirements over the years and stuff. And I'm not trying to say we graduate enough kids, we don't.
Mm.
Where we've had some big successes, where we've spent in a huge amount of money, tons of money, and we put mentors in there.
Mm-hmm.
But it's hard to do that all the way across the system because you can't really afford to put mentors in. Mm-hmm. We put 20 mentors supposedly into Jefferson to get that graduation
20
up.
Mentors?
20 mentors.
How much money?
20
How
extra.
Much money
I don't know what they're worth. They $50,000 a piece or something. Jesus. I don't know. But the graduation rate, because they were all doing it. But what I've always said, that's fine. It's fine the stuff we do in the high school. That's what Stanford children there get these things going in high school, which is all great. But really, you want to go down and fix the problem. And we're not teaching all the children to read.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I guarantee if you're not reading decently well, then you have a tough time graduating from high school.
Yeah.
So we don't teach them well enough, and we're trying to put in, we've got a whole new reading program that we brought in 10 schools last year, going to put it in a few more this year. But we haven't, and it really irritates me, we haven't put in all the money to do these programs to really get the kids real reading going.
Wow.
And so that's a bigger problem. We should be focusing there. Stand for Children. They're over worrying about, oh, the kid's already had 11 years of school, now we're going to fix them.
Oh,
no, go to the other one. I mean, that's fine. Of course, you want to fix them. But really, that is. But the other problem is in our middle grades, where kids, that's where kids drop out. They don't drop out then, but that's where the dropout comes. That's where they get sick at school. That's where they have all the problems often. We don't have engaging activities and things for them to do to engage them in school.
Like voc ed,
like athletics, like band, like art. Yep. Those things that, newspaper, yearbook, those things.
What are they going to do about that? Are they going to do anything?
Well, you see. Okay, I've got them on the right trajectory, but not there yet.
Wow.
And one of the things that I got them to do, here's what we were doing. We were funding schools based on the number of kids in them, not funding them based on equal programs. So if you're in school A, you maybe have a music teacher in your fifth grade class. School B, they don't have a music teacher. School C, they don't have a music teacher. School D does. Well, guess which are the more well-to-do schools? And the other thing is, guess who can buy those things? Sometimes they just buy them. There's a small number of schools, but they just buy them. But here's what happens. When you have the school that doesn't have the programs and stuff, parents go, nothing here, but over here there is. So maybe you'll move over here or move out of the district or figure out a way to send their kid over there.
But what happens when they
send the kid out? Then your numbers get smaller, you got less programs.
Then
they send, get more kids to go, then they got less programs. It's a vicious spiral. And the only way to, all our children should be in schools with programs which are equal.
Right.
And then once you get that all done, which, and I got them working on that, see? I think that's one of my two best things I did. I've got them working on that.
They're not complete yet.
No, but they're working on it, and they're serious about it. And then what
you
do, once you get that done, the programs, so they're the same, and then you put on top the special programs, the special ed, the TAG, the ELL programs, that's the English Language Learner, ESL programs, and other types of programs, you put those on top, see, according to the need. So they don't get subtracted. If you're going to have to take these ELL, it doesn't get subtracted out of your school that's poor. Yeah. Everybody gets equal programs, and then you put on. And we're working that direction. Well, I hope the people will keep working on it. But the Danielle...
You can't guarantee that, though.
Can't guarantee it, and Danielle understands it, though. He'll understand that. No sweat, because it's critical. So what would you do? You go up to Miss Sylvan, say, has 900 kids.
Does he have the support?
He got to get the support. People don't undercut him and give him support.
Right now. He just got a job.
He walks in, he don't have no support except the school board. They're all for him that I've seen.
And we got the issues that are facing us here within the
city. The only person I've seen talk out against Danielle, which would interest you again, is, he needed to have experience.
Who is this?
Pamela Knowles. But the deal you got to understand about why I think this is just guessing how she thinks this. She goes off to the big conferences and stuff and hobnobs with the hot shots around the country. So that would have been way in her favor to get one of the hot shots in here from another district. Well, a lot of those superintendents aren't that good, man. They're hard to find good ones.
But don't you think, though, Steve, she's been around for a long time. She's been on the school board for a long time. She's really been involved in representing those folks. But don't you think that things are sort of changing around now from the standpoint that the masses are finally getting to the table and saying, hey, I want my kid educated.
And
they understand, and they'll just, she understands a little bit more and can react to that?
No.
You don't think so?
She's the pushes back on it, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Instead of reacting and saying, she'll push back on it. Mm-hmm. So we don't like the guy coming in who's really smart and going to really do a good job. You're not going to influence him in the same manner, see? You're not going to influence...
But he needs support, though. He's got to have support.
Right, exactly. But he's so... I think he's so smart educationally that he'll get support in a lot of places, but you're not going to get support necessarily from Pamela Knowles, if he's kind of, it worries people because he thinks about all the children. He's going to think, he's got, I always had three philosophical things. One, that I tried to make every decision based on three philosophical things. One is all the children in the school district, every child's education is equally important.
Yeah, it
equally
be.
Important.
It
I don't care if they're the rich,
but, you know,
rich
you got,
kid.
But you got other issues you're dealing with.
Okay, right, right. But every kid's
major political issues.
But every kid's is equally important, and we've never treated that way. And this, and the second thing is that you should spend your money wisely. You shouldn't be out wasting your money.
But who's spending the money?
Well, the school board in the end does it.
Okay, and so you don't have the majority.
Right. So
they're the one that's signing the checks.
Right, but we're doing better with the money now.
Yeah, but that,
but we're not doing good enough, but we're doing better. But we're still correcting the old stuff from when Pamela Knowles was running the thing, and Matt Morton and Greg Blyle and Ruth Eggers, and before that, we're still correcting those. You know, if you go, we... this is amazing. If we were talking about, okay, where can we save money? Because we're going to be short money again, $18 million, supposedly.
Short? How are you going to be short? You just
because
told me
of the state.
You're looking at $2 billion with bond.
No, that's the bond. That's
bond?
That's all.
That's coming out of my pocket.
But that's all capital. You can't spend any of that money for, like, teachers or anything like that.
Oh, hey, but I've seen that. They've changed that.
You can't do that. No, you can't.
You sure?
Yeah, absolutely, 100% positive. Okay. You can't do that. And you have to spend the money for the capital stuff. But what I was saying, so I'm sitting in a meeting the other day, went to 140 of them this year on the school board. It's quite a few. And I counted them up because I got mileage for going to and from. But I'm sitting at the meeting, and they're talking about, okay, where are we going to get money? And I said, one of the places is some of the places where we contract with people.
Right.
Because we're bringing in people. Right. And we had some contractual abuses, and our stuff wasn't doing well, and we're fixing a lot of that. And I don't mean the CBOs, but just contract. We'll bring in somebody for something. And they said, okay, we've looked at all of it for $50,000 on up. And I said, okay, great. I said, but you got a lot of money below $50,000. You got maybe a $35,000 contract, or a $30,000, or $8,000, or $12,000. And the woman who's really good and smart woman who's kind of doing the finance now says, yes, we do. And I said, well, and she says, but we don't know where it is. We don't know where any of that money is.
What?
We don't know where it is. We do not have it and know where we spend it or where we're spending or where it is. We don't know where the money is. And she said, and it's going to take us more, in order to find it, it's going to take us so long that we're not going to find it before the next budget.
I can tell you can find it. You know who can find it for you? The media in Portland, Oregon.
It's not in the news now.
They're changing it. We don't have fake news in media in Portland, Oregon. Now, we have it outside of Portland, but they need to interview you. I mean, they've got the staff that can go out there and check their books out
that.
And this, that, and
well,
that.
We can, she'll it, find no, that no, money. You're missing
somebody
the point.
Sign that
you
check.
You're missing the point.
I sure have.
You're missing the point. And the point is that we don't have enough staff to put there while we're also putting together the budget to find all that money.
I agree.
Because we don't have it.
That's
crazy.
Let our media come in there and check that stuff out. Now, the other thing I was going to ask you about that money, and what about that art tax stuff? You got all kinds of money sitting up
there. That's for art. It goes all for art teachers.
But art, they define it in all kinds of mediums. You know, you can put that in. Art is art, right?
Well,
you can do that in voc ed.
When we get it, we put it in art.
The definition of art is that voc ed falls in that area. You know, like carpentry and metalwork and all that kind of stuff. That can be defined as art. I mean, the public would agree with that.
It's an interesting point.
I mean, They got a lot of money over there.
Not on art tax.
Yes, they do.
Well, we got a lot of money, but it's all going for art teachers.
Yeah, but
so you got to take the art teacher out of this.
I question where they're spending the money and why. You know, I did a piece on that. You know that. I just went through the mayor stuff, and we had some murals, if you will, and we're trying to prepare those.
Well, we're the art, but not when it comes to the schools. The part that we get in the schools.
I understand it.
Yeah,
understand
we're doing
it.
A good job.
As
far
as I'm concerned, the public would say, okay, fine, just give it all to the school.
You've got the art community. I'm not going to. I don't have to run for office again, but I don't want to insult the whole art community.
I'm a taxpayer. I'm paying you. I'm trying to figure out.
Okay.
What about the kids? Okay, no problem. Okay. Good. Okay, let's talk a little bit more. What about other problems? Any other major problems? What are some of the other major? Give me another two or three. You look like you're going to have to come back on here.
Major problems that we're facing right now or in the future?
The voc ed. Let's talk about the voc ed a little bit.
Voc ed is a problem, but we're addressing it be nice to have more money, but there's always the problem of, if you put money here, then you got to take it from someplace, and where do you take it from? There's not a lot of waste hanging around with these new people doing the finance stuff. There was, 3 years ago, quite a bit of waste hanging around, but not anymore. Now if you take, okay, so if you add voc-ed, that's fine, then you subtract from music, or you subtract from athletics, or do you subtract from your reading, where we'd have all these kids who can't read and we don't have reading teachers, or do you subtract? You got to subtract someplace. And people say, well, go up to the administration, correct? And I think there's truth in that, but it's not, there's not much up there. You still got to have somebody running your EL program, somebody running various things. You got to have people. We can't afford to put the maintenance guys out anywhere near what we should. I mean, you always got to pull from here to here to here to here. And I think that's a hard thing for a lot of people to get, that, yes, we should add this, but you got to think in terms of what it is and how it works.
You know what you're telling me?
I'm telling you there's not quite enough money to do all this stuff.
There's not enough people who have the background, if you will, to talk about this issue. I'll give you a good example. When I talk about voc ed aspect of it, I think about the trades. The trades. Why can't those people be at the table? A lot of those folks are retiring. They're looking to do something aspect of it. Now you're creating jobs. You're creating jobs because those people would be at the table. They know what the hell they're doing. It wouldn't cost you almost an arm and a leg, if you will. Put them in all those voc ed for those trades aspect of it. You got, and that is, you save a lot of money there. But people, because you don't have that background in the system, if you will, they can't relate like I relate, because I've been in the trades. Does that make sense?
Yes. What makes sense to me about what you say is that we should do a way better job at bringing in volunteer people.
Yes.
Way better job, because they're very helpful.
But my point,
we have a lot of great volunteers, but nowhere near what we should have. And for years, we went like this with the volunteers. We know what we're doing. Stay away. For years, we did that.
Because they're scared, because they don't know what they're doing.
Well, to some degree.
In the old style board,
we used to, that was the ball game.
Yeah.
We talked about it 100 times practically. Smooth it over and don't admit we made a mistake. Yeah. And that gets you in the mess, like you don't know where all the money under $50,000 is at. That gets you in the mess where it took us a long time to get voc-ed going. That gets you in the mess that we laid off all these reading teachers and haven't replaced them. That gets you in all sorts of messes, but it's not like, but a lot of those things are starting to straighten out. And that's why I really like this new superintendent, because he has the ability to straighten out a lot of the educational
stuff.
Let me ask a question.
Do you think we're a little too top heavy right now in the school, as far as administration?
There are some places
as opposed
where,
to the teachers. Are we spending more on teachers as opposed to administrators? Or are we just doing just the opposite?
When we compare across to other big districts, we're not top heavy.
No, I'm talking about Portland, Oregon.
But you're talking about whether we're actually top heavy.
Yes.
Because when we compare, where I think that we have problems is, We're not anywhere near top heavy in the facilities side. We don't have enough. I mean, we can't get people out to fix the stuff that needs to be fixed.
No, I know, but that's part of it.
That's part of it. Finances, I don't think we're top heavy. I think we're shorthanded probably. But we have some things we haven't built. But where we are is, we have people who deal with the education side that aren't really working with directly with kids, and we have a tendency to spend money on people who don't work directly with kids.
That's right.
And then we have blanks on the kids. For instance, we'll take someone and make them, and this is all over the country, by the way,
okay,
it isn't just Portland. We'll take someone and make them what they call a TOSA, teacher on special assignments, maybe literacy TOSA,
mm-hmm,
and their job is to come in and work with the teachers on literacy, but we can't find a reading teacher. I mean, we can't put in a reading teacher, but we can put in somebody to work with them on literacy, generalized literacy, but not a reading teacher. And for me, those are problems.
Right. I'm sorry.
And so that's okay.
I'm getting my
I've never been on
media.
TV and ever anybody bring up a phone before.
This is the true media right here, see. The other stuff is fake media.
On TV and you know what I'm saying? Probably hundreds of thousands of people watching the show are turning off right now.
I'm relying.
Probably turning off right now.
Oh, no, by no means. I mean, they're on.
Okay. All right. Anyhow, that's where I think. And we also don't spend some money wisely that we could gather back. I found about $7.5 million last year that I thought, just looking, and I wasn't doing stuff, but the new people are doing, we just did zero-based budgeting, which means we looked at everything we spent. We had parts of our things where we gave money with FTE, but not with money. In other words, so you're running my...
What's the FTE?
FTE is what it costs for one teacher on the average. So we gave you...
You put administration in there too?
Well, to some degree, it goes like this. I'm going to give you 12 FTE to run your department, okay? And let's say you're in charge of the ELL department. You get 12 FTE to run your department. But you don't know, but how much money is that? Because those are paid all over different amounts. So you don't even know how much money your budget actually is.
Well, how much are you paying that accountant?
Exactly. That's
you hired the person at about $100,000 or so.
Which one?
The accountant.
You mean the top guy?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's more than that.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
Still don't know where the money is.
No. He's the guy who's now starting to find it. That's the point. That's the point you're missing. Old board, no, can't tell where the money is. New people, they're trying to find the money, and they're going to put it back together. We had, for instance...
But that's ongoing.
It's ongoing.
Jesus Christ. It's insulting.
Well, Steve, it's not insulting. We're trying to fix
it. I've got about another 40 seconds to let them know, to tell the public, why they should allow you to leave that board, not run.
Because you got this excellent superintendent coming in who's going to do a whole lot of stuff that I can never get to because I can never get to four votes.
Well, you better be there with him.
Well, I support him.
And I take it.
And he's good.
So we're okay from the standpoint that you will be back on the show periodically.
Oh, yeah.
Once a month or whatever.
Well, I'll be around. I'm not going any place.
Maybe you can interview him.
You never asked me why I wasn't running.
Huh?
You never asked me there were three reasons.
No, I won't, because you're still running. Because you're still involved. That's the question. Indirectly, you're still involved.
It's just kind of eating my schedule up.
I know it is.
Eating it up.
We're both
retired.
We're still at that. I should be retiring, that's it. But I'm still here. That's why you got to stay here. Mm-hmm. Is that fair?
I'll be back.
In all due respect, you've done it.
Paying attention.
Job. Excellent job. Okay.
Let's get back together.
Maybe we can interview this guy together.
Well, okay. I'll do it together if you want, but this guy'll come on.
No, okay.
You had a tough time getting people in the past to come on, right?
Yes.
This guy'll come on and sit down with you.
To start with, the first one.
It's fine.
Okay, sounds good.
He'll do it.
Well, folks, as you can see, it's always a pleasure. It's enjoyable, if you will, to have Steve, and he's the only caretaker, as far as I'm concerned, Portland Public Schools right now. I mean, there are other folks there, but my point is we've been doing.
Anthony does a great job.
Paul does a good job. Hopefully, we'll get Paul to come on.
Tom Curler's
and follow
a great
up
guy.
And stuff. Okay, we'll get them together. But it's been a pleasure, buddy. Thank you very, very much.
Okay.
Enjoy your short vacation.
Well, I go until the 1st.
Till the 1st?
1st of July. Okay. That's my last. That's the first day I'm not there.
No, you're going to be on for that.
So I doubt if the building will fall down. But
I heard that. Folks, take care. Have a good one. I'll see you next week. I got an excellent show. Check out your Facebook. Anyway, we're going to make some announcements on that piece, okay? Have a good one. Enjoy your day.